So I first of all was a little confession, which is that I tend to see myself as an open-minded atheist who's full of self-question. And from the very first remarks, I noted something very similar to the opposite of me. The question was about the center. What is the nucleus of this polyhedron, and what is the connectivity between things? What holds everything together? The answer that you gave, Peter, if I may, is a transcendent center, which you then referred to as the true center. I would like some more information about that, because it also overlaps with what William was saying, I think, because for many atheists, of course, all gods are false gods. Consequently, I would like to know from William, how does an atheist like me distinguish between the false gods and what you refer to as a true god? Because I see an overlap in the vocabulary, the true center and the true god. I'd be very happy if you would enlighten me.
But I think the question goes to the principle of dialogue more than anything else. That the polyhedron is the result of a dialogue, not just between Jews and Christians and Muslims, monotheistic faiths, but all people of goodwill, all people who want to enter into it. And I think what's distinctive about polyhedric dialogue, as opposed to maybe Buber's I and Thou, is that it immediately brings into the discussion more than just a self and another. That in our globalized world, it's always about more than two reference points. What am I doing here as someone who grew up in the United States with a group of Latin Americans in China? I mean, there's more than one reference point in my presentation. And that's typical of the world in which we find ourselves today, that it's not just about me and another, but it's about entering into a polyhedric dialogue in which there's multiple reference points. There is a review or a speech that Bergoglio gave in Buenos Aires on a book by Luigi Giussani called The Religious Sense, but he highlighted in that book, I think the name of the poet is Giorgio Armani. He's a poet from Buenos Aires, I believe. Armani is the Horacio Armani, sorry. It was somehow Freudian. It was Horacio Armani. But it was about an atheist who had questions that he thought evoked her religious sense. So, as an atheist, you don't want to be baptized as religious, I recognize that. But, I mean, the polyhedron is a form of dialogue. To foster unity on the social level. But it is the case that Bergoglio, in his own self-understanding, understands the center to be the absolute. But it's a multi-pronged dialogue that is open to all who want to participate.
Yeah, thanks for your question, Stephen. I mean, I'm glad you raised it, because there can be a certain sort of aggressivity about this kind of idolatry critique. You're the heathens, and I'm the true believer, and so on. I do believe there's a true God, and there's no way I'm probably going to be able to convince you of that. But you asked about, like, how would you distinguish false from true? There's a famous commencement address that the novelist David Foster Wallace gave at Kenyon College in 2005. And among other things, he kind of occupies this sort of middle position between atheist and theist. But one of the things he said in this speech is he said, in actual day-to-day life, there's no such thing as atheists. He says, everybody worships the only question that you have is what to worship. And so he said, and so he goes through a list of different things, and he says that the main reason why you might want to consider worshiping a god or some spiritual sort of thing is that worshiping anything else is going to eat you alive. And then he goes through different examples where he says, you know, if you worship the body, then you're going to end up being considering yourself not beautiful enough. And if you worship money, you're never going to have enough, and all this kind of thing. And so he makes a sort of argument on abundance. You can take that or leave it. And again, there's kind of two versions of this. One is me trying to co-opt you into, through this idolatry critique, me trying to co-opt you and saying, you're not really an atheist. I know what you really are. You believe in something because everybody believes in something, and so on. And so there can be a kind of aggressivity to it. But the other way, and I think this is really where David Foster Wallace is kind of coming down, is in this kind of middle place where there then opens up this dialogue between different kinds of belief and different kinds of commitments. And I think that's kind of what Peter was getting at with this idea of dialogue too, is that you then begin to think of people not as divided into two completely different camps, those who have beliefs and those who have facts, but that in a certain sense, everybody has beliefs and commitments of different kinds, and then we can have conversations. So don't tell me I'm a believer and you're a non-believer. Let me tell you what I believe, you tell me what you believe, and then let's have a conversation. And so at least I think that's possible, and that opens up those kind of areas of dialogue. But again, of course, it's a very two-sided, it's a double-edged sword. I mean, it can be a very aggressive. The language of idolatry critique is almost always this kind of aggressive thing. But I think if you look at the underlying dynamic, it says that we all are kind of spontaneously seeking creatures, if you want to put it in that sense. And then we can have a conversation about what we're seeking and what we at least think we found. That where you and I might come into some, maybe not agreement, but at least mutual respect.
Well, I would just say that the mutual respect is there, that's not the problem. Where we would probably, I think, come together is the notion of solidarity. Which why I was wondering whether or not that is the connectivity within the polyhedron.
Yeah, certainly. And the other
about connectivity, social solidarity is the fruit of thinking about what it would mean to put politics at the service of the people for a proposal. But the other dimension of it, and I want to go back to those to see again. And this is fueled by a Christian vision, but it's not, Christians don't have a monopoly of it, but is our connectivity with all creatures, in the sense that the social doesn't rise above the biological or the beauty of diversity that's built into the grammar of what believers call the created order, that there's a responsibility there too. And that when we look for within to our inner lives, we're not just looking to how we connect to a people as a social entity, but also how we connect to this custodianship of the land that we've inherited that we want to give over to the next generation. So connectivity is a big deal in this thinking on multiple levels.
Thank you all, actually. My name is Liu Zhang, and I'm from China Institute for International Studies. Thank you for inviting me. And actually, I want to share some of my observations concerning to Pablo's presentation. So, as far as I know, I think you introduced this kind of phenomenon that there's some kind of the Chinese domestic programs, projects in Latin America. Have some kind of violation of the local, violation of local rules, local rules, and there was some kind of resistance of the local people against the Chinese investment project. I think China of now is, I admit that that is confronting this kind of phenomenon into in all of the world, but I think I would like to share an example of how the Chinese companies are resolving this kind of problem. Is that last week I and my colleague visited the China Northern Industrial Group, a corporation actually, Norinco, actually is a manufacturer of weapons. Its main business is to manufacture and produce and export the weapons in all over the world. But they also have some kind of civilians projects, like the mining and some other resources related project in more on more in Latin America, in Africa, in Southeast Asia. And they introduced that one of their invested programs actually is I think it's a copper a mining project in Southeast Asia and in Cambodia were also confronted with the local resistance because the local people several years ago in maybe in 2012 because the local people don't understand that they think that it's going to you know, to the Chinese workers is pouring into is their local community and grab the local working opportunities from the local people and may bring some kind of damage to the local environments. So they have the resistance. So the program has been hold for maybe 2 or 3 years. And but Chinese way and the company is a Chinese company, the Norinco. What the Norinco did is to, you know, to persuade the local people by introducing their own staffs, their own staffs and members of the workers of the company to persuade and to convince the local people that it's going to be help the local environment and to lift the local poverty by setting up some kind of simple programs. Then they just set up some the community schools and community hospitals and some affiliated facilities and infrastructural constructions and affiliated to the programs, and so that to let the local people see, this program, this mining program is really good and helpful for the local economic growth. And so I think the Chinese way is to not just to tell you it is good or not, but to also to do the things, so to show the local people that it's good. For the local welfare. So I think this is the Chinese way that the Chinese companies is in resolving problems that when facing about the local resistance to the Chinese domestic problems. So the Cambodian case is kind of, it has its own unique experience because you know the Southeast Asians share maybe some kind of similar cultural and thinking with Chinese people. So I think what China, the Chinese companies is doing now in the Latin American countries is kind of different from the Southeast Asian countries. But as you said, the second and third generation Chinese immigrants now in Latin America share the same feelings, share the same adaptations, identities with the Latin American people. So I think the people connected to can make the things go more smoother in the future. So I think the Chinese way can be introduced and can be studied in to resolve this.
No, I just, there's no question, it was just my observation.
Okay.
Bye-bye.